Whether you've read through the Bible 8 times or never know where to start, the 2022 Bible Reading Plan is a great way to dive into God's Word and grow in your relationship with Him. In just 15 minutes a day, you can read through the Bible in a year. Be sure to check it out at victorydenver.com/Bible.
Hey, Victory students, grades 6 through 12, come join our community on Thursday nights at 7, right here at the Westminster campus, and get connected to students your age through small groups and student events. Check out victorydenver.com/students and follow us on social at Victory Students Denver.
We believe that everything in life revolves around community. That's why we believe that small groups are an essential part of life. At Victory, there's a group or class for everyone. More details are available at victorydenver.com/groups.
Church, come on, stand to your feet right there where you are. Lift your voice up with me as we say, Lord, all we want is you. We want more of Jesus in this place. Y'all ready? Come on, y'all ready to worship? Let's go. Hey. Let your voice say, this world is not my home. I am just passing through. Earthly treasures soon will fail, but I found my hope in you. Come on, say, you are the one I want, you are the one I need.
The snow can have it all, they can take everything.
So it's a
give me Jesus, give me Jesus.
You are my treasure. Come on, you say,
the only lasting thing is you. You are forever.
Say, you are forever.
You are forever. You are the one that I run.
are my treasure.
You are my treasure.
Others may fail, but you remain.
You are my treasure.
You are my treasure.
Heaven and earth will pass away.
You are forever.
You are forever.
Jumping around today. It is so good to worship together. My name is Caitlin. I'm the kids director here. And if you're new, we want to say welcome. It is by no accident or coincidence that you're here. We believe God has a purpose for what he's going to share with you today. And if you are new, or maybe you just want to get connected with Victory, we would love for you to pull out your phones and text Victory Denver to 94,000. That way you can find out more about our church, or maybe you're wondering, hey, I'm ready to serve. What's my next step? Let me tell you, church is a team sport, and we're ready to put you in the game. So we would love for you to, again, text Victory Denver to 94,000, especially as we're preparing for Easter. Let's stock up our volunteer team so we can welcome a whole bunch of new people into our church to hear the good news of the gospel. You can also send in a prayer request or join a small group, and you can text to give as well. And as we transition into a time of offering, you can give online if you're watching online, or you can give here in person as the buckets are going to pass soon. But I was thinking about it, and giving 10% of your offer, of your income, that's a tithe, or above and beyond, that's an offering, that can feel a little intimidating if you don't know the character of God. When you know that God is good and loving and just and trustworthy and faithful, more faithful than your biweekly income, you can trust and obey what he's asking you to do. And so we thank you guys for partnering with us and taking that step of obedience and faith and saying, God, I believe that you can do way more with this 10% that I'm going to give away than if I were to keep it all for myself. We're going to get to impact the world and our community by the way that God uses it. So will you guys pray with me really fast? God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you that we can trust your character because you are good. We love you, God, and we believe that you are faithful. We pray that today we know you more than we knew you yesterday, and that tomorrow we know you and your character even more than we found out today. Would you reveal yourself in new ways to us, especially as we step forth in our giving today? Would you take it and use it for exceedingly abundantly more than we could ask or imagine? We trust you, Jesus, and we place everything we have in your hands. We're giving it back to you. It's in your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Will you join me in worship again?
No one like you.
Come on. Like you.
No one like you.
No one like you.
Say no one like you.
No one like you.
Say no one like you. All right, Victory, you ready?
No one
hey, everybody
like
say
you.
Say no one like you.
No one like
everybody
you.
Say no one like
here today. There's nobody like you. There's nobody who can compare to his greatness, to his glory. Right there where you are, just lift your hands up and repeat after me. Saint Jesus, you're so amazing, and all I can say is there's no one like you. Come on, lift your voice. Say Jesus.
Jesus,
you're so amazing, Lord.
You're so amazing.
And all I can say, and all I can say is there's no one like you. I want to sing that bridge one more time. Right there where you are, lift your hands, close your eyes, and say Jesus. Say Jesus. Come on.
You're so amazing, and all I can say is there's no one like you.
Nobody like you, Lord.
Jesus, you're so amazing, and all I can say is there's no one like you.
Everybody in this place, close your eyes. And say, pour it out. Pour out your blessings.
We see what you can do, oh God of wonders. Your power has no end. Things you've done before in greater measure, you will do it again. 'Cause there's no prison wall you can break through, no mountain you can move. All things are possible. There's no broken body you can raise, no so that you can say all things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up. You can light it up, oh God of revival. Let hope arise, death is overcome. You've already won. Oh God of revival,
yes.
You rose in victory. forever on the throne.
Come on, let's sing it together. Say,
so why should my heart fear what you defeated? I will trust in you alone. There's no prison wall you can break.
Church,
pour it out
over my children.
presence, more of your spirit. Hey, come on, the great God deserves a great praise today. Hey, woo. Oh man, y'all done? I'm not done. I don't think the Holy Spirit's done either. Come on, you think the Holy Spirit's done working? Nah, you think he's done moving? Nah, he's still flowing. He's still doing a new thing. He's still doing a great thing. Listen, I want to sing that chorus one more time, because I just sense in my spirit that some of us are walking through dark nights right now. Some of you are walking through dark nights and you cannot wait to see the sunrise. But you're saying, God, this night is the longest night of my life. I'm surrounded by darkness. I'm surrounded by fear. I'm surrounded by the enemy. And I don't know how much longer I can take. I don't know how much more I can take. But I want us all to believe that the darkest night, he can light it up. Doesn't matter what you're going through, he can light it up. There's no shadow that can hide from his goodness. There's no demon that can run from his power. There's no sickness that can overcome his mighty strength. Come on, sing this with me. Say, the darkest night, you can light it up. Come on, come on.
You can light it up.
Oh, God of revival, let hope arise. Death is overcome. You've already won.
Oh, God.
One more time, say the darkest night, the darkest night. You can light it up, yes, Lord.
You can light it up, oh God of revival.
So let hope arise, let hope arise. Death is overcome. Come on, proclaim it, say, you've already won, oh God of revival. Say that one more time, let hope arise. Let hope arise. Death has overcome. You've already won. Oh God of revival.
One more time.
Let hope arise. Let hope arise. Death has overcome. You've already won. Oh God of revival. Let hope arise. You all may be seated.
Amen. You are in the house of the Lord today. Come on, let's thank God that we're here. Welcome to all of you that are online, wherever you may be. We just want to give you a good, hearty welcome. Thanks for coming and being part of Victory Church. And as always, I just want to thank all of you and all of you that are watching. As you support this church with your tithes and your gifts, you're just making a huge difference in the lives of so many people. And so I just want to personally thank you. And I think you ought to thank God for what he's done in your life as he's blessed you. Come on, let's thank the Lord. He is so amazing in our lives. Amen. In case you don't know who I am, if you're new with us, I'm Pastor Mike Ware. I'm the founding pastor of Victory Church. And I've been covering for Matt while he's out. And so I know you miss him, but soon he'll be back. Meanwhile, you have the highly talented, highly motivated, saved, sanctified, full of the Holy Ghost, Super Bowl champion backup quarterback, and your coach, me. Right before I got up here, you know, I felt like the Lord whisper in my ear. I felt the Holy Ghost say, go get him, coach. So I'm here to come and get you. Amen. Amen. I want you to know that all I ever think about is winning. I never think about losing. I'm not a loser. You're not a loser. We think about winning. I mean, winning and victory and triumph ought to be in your mind at all times. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Losers think about losing. Winners think about winning. And I want you to know that winning is a habit. And a lot of Christians are used to losing. And that's not normal. You pray and you don't get an answer and you think that's normal. You ask God to be healed, you don't get healed. You think that's normal. You go to cast out a demon, he doesn't go, and you think that's normal. Can I tell you what? That is not normal. Not normal for somebody like you because you're on a winning team. I'm not coaching losers. I'm coaching winners. Amen? And we're here to make a little history. But what your enemy doesn't know is that he thinks you're weak and unassuming. He doesn't think you can do anything. When he growls, he thinks you're going to lay down. What our enemy doesn't know is that we might look weak and look small and unassuming, but we've got faith and a fight. I'm telling you, you have everything that you need right now to fight principalities and powers and rulers of darkness and spiritual wickedness in high places. You know, Frank D. Azar, the local attorney that always is advertising nonstop, he calls himself the strong arm. He said, I've been fighting insurance companies all my life. He said, they don't scare me. Well, guess what? You and I have been battling and fighting demons all our life. They don't scare us because we got the strong arm of the Holy Ghost. Amen? I'm coaching winners. Do you know what to do? It's 1, 2, 3, victory. You know what to do? I want to hear winners right now. You ready? 1, 2, 3, victory. Come on now, that's winners. Some of you are saying, that is really corny. Well, Jimmy cracked corn, and I don't care. It probably is corny. But I'm your coach. I'm trying to get you on the team. I'm here to motivate you, to inspire you, to let you know that you're not normal. You're peculiar. You've got power that this world doesn't have. You've got authority this world can't understand. And we're sitting on it. We don't even think about it. And I'm trying to awaken you. I'm trying to get you to rise up and be who God called you to be. I've been in this series called The Invisible War, The Unseen Realm. And we need to wake up because this unseen war, this battle is for your soul. It's for your emotions. It's for your family. It's for your future. And we sometimes write off all these problems as circumstances or bad luck or fate or acts of God. And we live like there is no real spiritual enemy who comes to steal, kill, and destroy. That's how Jesus described him. And in this series, what I've been doing is I've been trying to peel back the curtain of heaven, open up the Bible to reveal to you that you have an enemy. That enemy is ruthless. He's dangerous. He's vicious. And it's time we expose who he is and what he does and how to defeat him. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 2, he said, lest Satan should take an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. And I've been teaching you over these last few weeks, so you're not ignorant. I'm here to learn you something and to teach you something, to get an education. And I want to remind you that a third of Jesus' ministry, I think I mentioned this a few weeks ago, a third of Jesus' ministry dealt with demons. When Jesus was resurrected, the demons didn't disappear. They're still there. They're not in hell yet. I said yet. They're going to be there one day. But I mean, if Jesus had to deal with a third of his ministry dealing with demons, what makes you think you're exempt? That you don't have to deal with them. That's why Paul said he doesn't want you ignorant of the devices of the devil. Now, over the last few weeks, I've been teaching you how to prepare for battle. And then I taught you on preparing yourself for battle. And then last week, I spoke on dressing for battle. And today, I want to speak to you about, I think, the greatest battle that you'll ever face, and that is winning the mind battle. Winning the mind battle. Everything starts and ends in your mind. And I'm going to tell you, the devil knows this. If you can win the battle of the mind, you can defeat the devil. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Defeat and victory is determined in your mind. That's why I told you earlier, I don't ever think about defeat. I don't ever think about being a loser. I think about being a winner because I know God is for me. God is with me. I mean, I can stand up and fight. I'm not going to lose. I'm not a loser. You're not a loser. But I'm going to tell you the battle is in your mind. And look, if you can't win the battle in the mind, all the weapons, all the authority, and all the power of God are useless. I want you to know that the greatest spiritual battles you're going to face are in your mind. And we're going to go a little deeper today. Is that all right? Can you go deeper? Well, the mind is where the battlefield is located. And Satan is a master at the mind games. He can tempt you. He can try you. He can trick you, and he can trap you with thoughts and ideas. That's what he does. I mean, if he can get you to chase rabbits with your thoughts, you'll never chase God with your life. And if you're going to win spiritually, you've got to win mentally. We're not here to tie games. We're here to win games. George Allen, who was the former coach of the Washington Redskins, I mean, they had a long battle in the whatever game they were playing. I don't know who they were playing, but they had a long game. I mean, it went multiple overtimes. It ended up in a tie. You know what he said? He said, a tie is like kissing your sister. Look, we're not here to tie the game. We're here to win the game. Can I hear an amen? Reminds me of a church service where Satan showed up. I mean, Satan appeared, and all of a sudden, everybody's screaming and hollering, fearful. I mean, they're trampling each other, getting out the door. I mean, everybody was out in just a matter of a minute, except for one older man that was sitting on the front row, just sitting there calmly, not even paying attention to anything. I mean, Satan was fuming that he was still there. I mean, that the man was unmoved. And Satan said, don't you know who I am? He said, yep, sure do. Said calmly. He said, you're not afraid of me? He said, nope, sure not. He said, why aren't you afraid of me? He said, I'm not afraid of you because I've been married to your sister for 52 years. Psst, ching. Some of you might feel that way right now. Don't you say it. Don't you say it. Here's the advice Paul gave Timothy. 2 Timothy 1, he said, God has not given you a spirit of fear, but a power of love and of a sound mind. Look, it's easy to be intimidated by the devil, but God has given you not a spirit of fear, but power and love and a sound mind. Look, we don't have a fear spirit. We've got a power spirit, a love spirit, a sound mind spirit. Look, you've got power to overcome anything. You got love. Love, the Bible says love casts out all fear. Isn't that right? Perfect love casts out fear. And you have a sound mind that you can be disciplined and self-controlled. Come on, church. God has not given you a spirit of fear. He hasn't done that. And I want you to know something. When you're afraid, when you're scared or fearful, you've lost God's power. You've lost God's love. You've lost a sound mind. And you know, that fear always starts in the mind. And I've been watching over the last 2 years when COVID started. Now, I'm not saying COVID is, it's evil. It's bad. I know it. We've lost people. We know. But you know what? We've let fear dictate our lives. Fear. Now they're all saying the pandemic's over. Of course, we know that's not true. But other things now, they're trying to bring fear in your life because fear can control you. Fear is something that comes through your mind. God has not given you a spirit of fear. But power, love, and a sound mind. God has given you a mind that is sound so that when fear comes to try to attack you, because fear will motivate you to do things you would not normally do. I want to show you this scripture. Look, we're all in a mind battle. In 2 Corinthians 4, Paul said in verse 3, he said, the gospel is hid to those that are lost. And then in verse 4, he said, whose minds the God of this age has blinded. The God of this world is devil, and he has blinded the minds of those who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. I want you to see that Satan is a mind blinder. He comes to blind your minds You know what he blinds your minds to? To the gospel of truth and the gospel of light. Look, he can't keep it out of the world, so he tries to keep it out of your mind. He blinds. That means to, the Greek word means to darken the mind, to envelop in smoke, to wrap in a mist. Some of you feel like you're in a fog. Mentally, you're in a fog. Can I tell you what it is? It's a spirit. It's the devil who's coming to blind your minds to the real truth of life. He doesn't want you to know truth. He doesn't want you to walk in the light of God. He wants you to walk in darkness all of your life. Listen to what I'm about to tell you. You can win the battles of life if you can win the battles in your mind. It's the hardest battle you're ever going to fight. And you'll see it here in just a moment. But I know you can close the door. You can slam the door on the devil if you can get control of your mind. Get control of your thoughts, because your mind is where he plays. It's what he corrupts. It's where he brings doubt. It's where he brings fear. And if he can convince you of something, he can change your destiny by your thoughts. If you capture his thoughts, he captures your future. I've just made a decision a long time ago. I'm not going to think the way the devil thinks. I'm not going to think the way the world thinks. That's what makes me corny. Here's what it says in 1 Peter chapter 5. It says, be careful, watch out for attacks from the devil, your great enemy. He prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for some victim to devour. Verse 9 says, take a firm stand against him and be strong in your faith. Remember that your Christian brothers and sisters all over the world are going through the same kind of suffering you are. The Bible calls your enemy, he calls him your great enemy, your adversary. That means your opponent. You've got an opponent. You know, we've been talking about being in the game. You've got an opponent. He's on the other side of the ball. He's trying to keep you from scoring. He is your arch enemy. We have an enemy that wants to blind our minds, blind you to the power of the Holy Ghost, blind you to the power of God's Word, blind you to the authority that God has given you. You know, I was thinking about this week, and I really hope I get a chance to preach on this. I don't know if I can squeeze it all in. There's so much to talk about in this series. But you know, Jesus said, if I by the finger of God cast out demons, he said, the kingdom of God has come unto you. I want you to know you got a finger of God that's got authority in it right now. We need to learn how to use it. The devil's tried to trick you and tempt you and to trick you and trap you so that you don't believe you've got anything. You just come and sit in church. No, we're not sitters. We're doers. We're on the team. We're in the game. We're off the bench. This is my pep talk right now for this game we're in. You know, the devil never speaks to your mind. He always, speaks to your spirit. He always speaks to your mind. Isn't that true? God speaks to your spirit. The devil always speaks to your mind. And the reason why is because with the mind, he can talk you in or out of things. With the mind, he can limit you or loose you. He can poison you or can perfect you. Your mind can do this. Your mind can bury you or bless you. The mind is the keeper of your destiny. It's the igniter of your faith. And God has a lot to say about your mind. Romans 12, verse 2, it says, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The Bible says you can have this mind that's in Christ. You can have this mind. You're to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. I'm going to tell you, the Lord has a lot to say about the mind, because he knows the mind is where the devil plays. The greatest battle you ever fight is going to be in your mind. It's going to be how you think. And if there's anything that will block the treasures of heaven, it's how you think. So how do you win these battles? How do you win the mind battles? I want to give you four. I want to give you four levels of how the devil comes to attack you in your mind. And I'm going to tell you, they're progressive. They build one on another. If you don't recognize those, look, we're going deeper. I told you we're going deeper. If you don't start recognizing these different levels that we're talking about today, he's going to get you. He's going to capture you. He's going to chain you. I already told you, we're winners, not losers. So I'm going to show you how to win this battle right now, the battle of your mind. Are you ready? The four levels of the mind attacks. Number one, level one is imaginations. Imaginations. The key to understanding demonic attack is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. You know the verse, casting down imaginations. and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Okay, the Lord makes it really clear that we are to cast down imaginations and every high thing. He talks about imaginations. It starts right there. That's where it starts in your mind, is an imagination. And I want you to notice that thoughts or imaginations occur in the realm of the mind. This is where the battle is. It's in your mind. Many have said that the mind is the devil's playground. I think it's very, very true. Just about everything I've ever had to deal with in my whole life came because of stuff that came in my mind. Come on, am I the only one like this? I remember when I was a little boy. You know, I always thought, when I went to bed, I always thought if I hung my arm off the bed, something under the bed was going to grab me and drag me under it. Now, when the lights were on, I looked under there. There was nothing under there. Maybe some dirty clothes, but nothing was under there. But when the lights went out, suddenly the imagination. This is what the devil does to you. And I thought I was going to be drugged to the abyss or something. I didn't know what was going to happen. I made sure that I was far away from the edge. It was an imagination. That word imagination, it means the formation of images. You know, God has given you a mind so that you can do this. I mean, in your mind, it's creative. You can create things. You can see things. You can make a movie in your mind. You can see things that are moving. Isn't that right? Now, let me give you an example. Everybody close their eyes for just one moment. Just close your eyes for a moment. And here's what I want you to see in your mind. I want to show you the creativity of your mind. I want you to see a monkey peeling a banana and eating it. Okay? I want you to see that. Can you see that? Can everybody see that monkey? Amen. See, that's your mind. Okay, with your eyes still closed, you see the monkey peeling the banana? Now, I want you to picture that monkey sitting on the top of a pig eating a banana. Can you see it? Everybody look at me. Can you see it? See, your mind is so creative. You can imagine things. You can see things. You know what that monkey was doing? That monkey was eating high on a hog, in case you're wondering. Just wanted to make sure you understood that. See, the mind is the place where sin proceeds. You know, you just don't wake up one morning and say, hey, I'm going to go rob a bank. No, you think about it. You don't wake up one day and say, I'm going to put a needle in my arm and just shoot some stuff up in there. No, you think about it. Come on, isn't that right? I mean, you don't put something in your Amazon cart and then click checkout and put debt on your credit card without thinking about it. Come on, am I right? See, everything starts with a thought, an imagination. Every action that leads to sin begins with an imagination. Everybody knows who King David was, the second king of Israel. While everyone was off to battle, he stayed home. One night, I imagine, as I've read the story, he went out on his balcony to look at the beautiful night. And there on a rooftop not far away was a woman who had not pulled the curtains all the way closed, and she was taking a bath. And he started looking at her. And boy, she was hot and good looking. He began to think and imagine in his mind, what would it be like to be with her? An imagination. Next thing you read about, David committed adultery. From an imagination. James explains it this way, James chapter 1. But each one is tempted when he's drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's full grown, brings forth death. Let me say it the way I like to say it. Sow a habit, reap a sin. I'm sorry, sow a thought and reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a sin. Sow a sin and reap a destiny. Let me say it again. Sow a thought, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a sin. Sow a sin and you reap a destiny. It all starts with a thought. See, it's the hardest battle you're ever going to fight in your life. Are these battles in your mind, the imaginations that come? You know, when the devil initiates his attack, he begins very subtly just interjecting a thought into your mind. It's what I mean by an imagination. It's a thought. It's an imagination. It's a suggestion. It's something you speculate on or you reason with or you start to think about. We need to discern thoughts and imaginations and reasoning. You know, when you have a thought, it's up to you to compare that thought to the truth of God's Word. This is the hard part. Because everything we do should be filtered through the Word of God. Look, I sometimes am able to do it. Sometimes I'm not. Sometimes I'm just like all of you. That thought just, it gets there, and I think on it. You know, you can stop many wrong thoughts dead in the tracks, their tracks. If you could just do this, if you could just ask yourself, is this a thought from God? That's a question you ought to ask sometime. When fear comes, doubt, unbelief, is this a thought from God? I mean, how can you cast down an imagination if you don't know where that imagination comes from? You've got to figure out the source of it. What is the source of it? I mean, you have to compare that imagination and thought sin to God's Word, because that's what He provides for us. It's His Word to filter things through. Look, if you can't recognize or won't recognize that Satan tries to infiltrate your mind, you'll never recognize his attacks. You'll never know what he's doing. And you'll accept his thoughts as your thoughts. A good example is Eve in the Garden of Eden. There she was in the Garden of Eden, and Satan tempted her, and she said, you know, the Lord said we can eat from every tree but one. Remember when she said that? When Satan tempted her with an imagination, she said, we can eat of every tree but except one. In the beginning, she knew the truth. She knew what God's Word was. I mean, she knew exactly what God said. You can eat of all trees, but that one over there, don't eat it, whatever you do. So when Satan tempted her, I mean, it was really easy for her to reject that thought, that imagination. I mean, if she would have just terminated the conversation right there and just said, I reject that in Jesus' name or in God's name, I reject that, and turned away, all of humanity would be different right now. But that's not what happened to her, because she began to entertain the thought of that Satan gave her. You know, Satan planted the thought in her that it's okay to eat that forbidden fruit. I mean, it's good. It looks good. It probably is going to taste good too. And he said, you know, God knows if you eat this fruit, you'll become wise like God, and that's not bad. And she began to think, you know, you're probably right. That's not bad. I mean, I think God would want me to be wise like him. If I was wise like him, we would have a lot in common. Can you see what's happening? A thought. Eve believed the lies of the devil, and she was deceived by the serpent's cunning, and she let her mind lead her astray. Here's what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 11. He said, but I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, that your minds, watch what he says, your minds may somehow be led astray. In other words, distracted by an imagination. He said that your minds may somehow be led astray from your sincere and pure devotion to God. See, Paul understood this thing about an imagination and about thoughts. He had more to say about it than anyone, any other writer in the Bible. Look, the best thing you can do when the devil tries to engage you with thoughts and imagination is to cast them down. Cast them down. If you can discern the source of the thought, you can cast them down. I told this story years and years ago. I had a little lump underneath my scalp right here, and it kept getting bigger and bigger, and I got a little concerned about it in the beginning, and then I heard a little voice, and that little voice said, it's cancer and you're going to die. I knew right off that was not God. That's not how God deals with things. I knew right off it was the devil. Now, I don't recommend you do this, but on purpose, I waited a whole year before I went to the doctor. I mean, that's where my faith was. I don't know where your faith was, but I knew the devil was a liar. I was not going to entertain that imagination that this is cancer. It kept getting bigger and bigger. When I went to the doctor's office, they cut it out, and they were going to send it to the lab. When he got it out, he said, oh, it's just a sebaceous cyst. He said, it's not that big a deal. I said, can you put that in a jar for me? He said, what for? I said, I want to take it home as a souvenir of my visit. They looked at me like a cow at a new gate. I'm telling you, I got that in my office. It's in my house. You know the reason why? It's a testimony that he's a liar, and God tells me the truth. If you can cast it down, if you can cast down that imagination before it has a chance to get planted in your mind, you can have some victory. This is level one, imagination. Level two is high thoughts. High thoughts. Many times we don't stop the imagination that comes into our minds, and maybe it's because we don't recognize it or we don't understand how dangerous those imaginations can be, and so we just kind of let them sit there. Look, if we don't stop the imaginations, they can turn into a high thought. A high thought. Paul said to cast down imagination and everything that exalts itself, or a high thing that exalts itself. He's talking about thoughts. The second level of the battle of your mind is the high thoughts. Now, I want you to know that you can't stop thoughts from coming. They're just going to come. Isn't that right? I mean, that thoughts come. I mean, I can try to shut off the flow, but I mean, they still come. I can't help it. But when they come, I have to discern, are they from God or not? If they're not from God, then I've got to cast them down. I've got to chain them up and drag them to the foot of the cross and say, Jesus, here's that thought. It doesn't belong to me. It belongs to the devil. I'm going to leave it at the foot of the cross. When I get another one, I'll chain it up and bring it to the cross. You know, you can't stop thoughts from coming. I can't stop birds from landing on my head. But I can keep them from building a nest. A high thought, I want you to get this, a high thought comes when you begin meditating on an imagination. Okay, you got to get this. I'm trying to show you what the devil does. When you have an imagination and you begin to meditate on it, think about it, reason with it, it becomes a high thought. It's a progressive level. If the devil can get you with an imagination, he's going to try to get you next. By meditating on that imagination to turn it into a high thought. Let's go back to Eve for just a moment, because the devil said, did God really say don't eat from the tree? She said, yeah, that's what he said. Then the devil said, well, God just doesn't want you to be wise like him. And I think she started thinking about that and turning that over in her mind over and over and over again. The scripture said that she saw the tree was good for food. She should have just turned her back and walked away. I mean, who talks to serpents anyway? But anyway, I thought that's weird. But in her mind, she was probably saying, well, what could be wrong with that fruit? I mean, it is good to eat. It's good to the eye. It's good to eat. I mean, what would be wrong with one little bite, one little taste? I mean, it would make me wise. See, she had an imagination that she meditated on that's now becoming a high thought. In Genesis 3, verse 6, so when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave to her husband and he ate. Her thoughts were pulling her farther and farther away from God's word. I hope you see this. Because she thought, the fruit is beautiful. It looks good. It probably tastes great. It will make me wise. What could be wrong with that? That's exactly what the devil wanted her to think. Here's the progression. It starts with an imagination. When you meditate on the imagination, it becomes a high thought. Eve meditated on that thought, that imagination, for a long time, and it turned into a high thought. And I believe one thing that the devil said that was a clincher, he said, it's a tree desirable to make one wise. And she thought, that's it. I want to be wise. I want to be wise. And she stepped, I'm going to tell you what she did. She stepped forward, she stretched out her hand, and she plucked that fruit off that vine or off that limb. And she put it to her mouth, and she took a bite of it. And at that moment, sin entered into mankind. And they were cast out of the Garden of Eden. And a curse was placed upon humanity because of that sin, because of one bite that started with an imagination. Are you following where I'm going on this? I'm going to tell you, this is an advanced technique. This is going deeper. But I'm trying to tell you how to win these games. An imagination that she meditated upon that turned into a high thought. Level one, imagination. Number two, high thought. That takes us to number three, strongholds. Level three is strongholds. When Eve took the fruit, ate it, she moved to the third level of demonic attack, and that's a stronghold. Look, when your imagination, when you meditate on it and it leads to a high thought, and that high thought, you begin to act on that high thought, you enter into a place of a stronghold. Did you follow what I just said? An imagination that you meditate on turns into a high thought. When you act on the high thought, like Eve did, it turns into a stronghold. Now look, I'm not saying that every time you sin, you're creating a stronghold, but I'm just saying if you consciously sin over and over again, it gets easier and easier and easier to the point to where you're building a stronghold. I mean, every time you sin in the same area, you know what happens? You get a brick and you're building a wall, a stronghold around your life. And you don't even know it. It started with an imagination, turned into a high thought that you acted on. Paul says it this way, 2 Corinthians 10, he said, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, high things that exalt themselves against the knowledge of God. He's saying the strongholds, imaginations, and high thoughts are all connected together. They're all connected together. This is the progression of the devil, imagination, high thoughts, strongholds. I want you to follow me on this. Because your imagination that turns into a thought that results in an action can be a tightening grip on your life. You know what the word stronghold means? It means a stronghold. It means a tightening grip. Sally Ann texted me after our service that we had for our volunteers. She said it's like a boa constrictor. They don't bite you to kill you. I mean, they don't bite you with venom. They just start slowly squeeze you to death. That's what the devil does. That's what a stronghold is. Habitual sin can lead to the building or establishing of a stronghold in your mind. When that happens, Satan has access to that part of your life. Are you following what I'm saying? And you're going to find it difficult to resist him because it becomes a pattern of behavior, a habit that's hard to break and overcome. I'm sensing right now that for some of you, the light has gone on. Because now you just sense that, wait a minute. I've got a stronghold in my life. I've got an area of my life that I don't have a lot of control over. You know what's happened to you? You've moved into level three. You let an imagination turn into a high thought that turned into a stronghold. I mean, you try to resist. You're successful in that one area of sin in your life. You're successful in it for a while, and then all of a sudden something happens and it triggers you, and you fall right back into that sin. I'm going to tell you, if you don't deal with imagination, thoughts, and strongholds, one day you're going to fall in that hole and the devil's going to cover it over with you in it. There's some people that have a repeating pattern in their life of sin. And this ought to be a wake-up call for you because you never even knew it, you never paid attention. You're already at level three. You have a stronghold and you never knew it. Never knew it. If you give the devil a foothold, he will build a stronghold. A stronghold is a foothold. A stronghold is a door that has a key in it. And some of us have taken the key and just handed it to the devil. And he opens and closes that door at will in and out of your life because of an imagination that you meditated on, that turned to a high thought that you acted on, that turned into a stronghold, a grip that's tightening around your life. And you can have a stronghold in one or many areas, but I mean, a lot of Christians, they just have one stronghold that kind of binds them and holds them. I mean, 98% of their life is right. Fine. I mean, probably 98% of your life is really good. You got the light of God in there, but there's 2% that's full of darkness. And it torments you. I mean, you feel guilty about it. You feel condemned about it. Sometimes we don't do very much about it because it's so little. It's such a little part of our life. You know, the little fox will spoil the vine. A little leaven leavens the whole lump, isn't that right? It reminds me of a man that was in our church a number of years ago, and he came to church, he had a bandage on his foot. I said, what happened to you? He said, well, I have a cut on my foot. And he didn't take care of that cut, by the way. He just kind of let it go and didn't clean it or anything. He got infected. So he had a bandage around his foot. Well, next week when he came to church, he had a bigger bandage. I said, how are you doing? He said, well, they had to cut one of my toes off. It's just a little thing, a little cut. Didn't take care of it. Next week when he came to church, he had a bigger bandage. He said, they had to cut all my toes off. I'm not lying. This is the truth. A week later, he came and he had crutches. And they had cut half of his foot off. A week or so later, he came in a wheelchair and they'd taken his whole foot off. Infection. 2 weeks later, he was dead. All because of a little thing that he didn't take care of. Just like you, the little imagination that you just allow to run rampant in your mind. You're not willing to filter it through God's word to know whether it's from God. You don't know the source of it, so you entertain it. You meditate on it. Then it comes into a high thought. Then you start thinking about acting on it. And next thing you know, you have a stronghold. Level one, imaginations. Level two, high thoughts. Level three, strongholds. Number four, level four is oppression. This is how the devil takes you. He takes you each step. If he hooks you on the first one, he'll try to hook you on the second one, then the third one. So he can do one thing to oppress you. Now, there's a difference between oppression and possession. Now, I don't have time to get into this because I'm really short on my time right now. But I don't believe, this is my personal belief, I do not believe a Christian can be possessed. I think you can be oppressed, but I don't think you can be possessed. I'll tell you the reason why. Because the Bible says you've been bought with a price. You are already owned by God. The devil can't own you. You've already been purchased, if you will. Amen? Are you following what I'm saying? So he can't possess me. Now, he can oppress me in the areas that I've opened the door to him in because of thoughts, high thoughts, strongholds. The problem is that most Christians don't recognize they can be oppressed by a demon, so they don't really do anything about it. They don't want to think that a demon can harass them. And you know what? You're at the mercy of the devil all your life if that's how you think. So let me be really straight with you. If you consistently yield an area of your life to sin, you are allowing the devil an entrance to that part of your life. Does that make sense what I'm saying? That's called oppression. The word oppression means to have a sense of heaviness or obstruction in the body or mind, to be weighed down, to be burdened spiritually or mentally. You know, a lot of people that are depressed, can I tell you what that is? It's oppression. They've been oppressed. That's why they're depressed. I'm not saying all depression is that way because we all know people that have mental things. They need some counseling on. They might need medication. But I'm going to tell you the majority of it is oppression from the devil. Started with an imagination that they never cast down. It ended up in a high thought that they never dealt with. And they ended up with a stronghold in their life that they just let it be allowed in their life. And next thing you know, they're oppressed. You don't have to live this way. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Here's a good illustration. I'm going to close with this. In Luke 13, Jesus said he was teaching in the synagogue on a Sabbath. And behold, there was a woman who had a spirit of infirmity. I want you to notice, a spirit of infirmity for 18 years. And was bent over and could in no way raise herself up. But when Jesus saw her, now watch this. He called her to him and said to her, "Woman, you are loosed from your infirmity." And he laid hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. Now, here was a woman who went to church every week, just like you do. Probably loved the Lord. But she had a spirit of infirmity. It wasn't a disease. It was not an affliction. It was none of those things. Jesus called it what it was, a spirit of infirmity. A spirit of infirmity is from the devil. She had a spirit of infirmity. And Jesus delivered her and freed her from that spirit of oppression. I want to show you something so this will encourage you. Acts 10, verse 38, it says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed. That means every one of us, he comes along to heal everyone who is oppressed. Today, you can be demon free. You can be oppression free because Jesus goes about healing everyone that's oppressed. Yes, it may have started with an imagination. Yeah, you may have meditated on it, became a high thought. Maybe you acted on that high thought. Next thing you know, you're being squeezed. You've got a stronghold. So you didn't do anything about it. Now you're oppressed. Can I tell you right now, Jesus understands that spirit of oppression. He can free you right now. You need to be free. I'm asking you, do you need to be free from imaginations, from high thoughts? Stand up on your feet. From strongholds in your life. If that's you, I'm going to get our prayer team down here. I want you to get out of your seats. I know what the devil's going to tell you right now. You don't need to go. You don't need to go. You're okay. Are you going to finally listen to him, or are you going to listen to God? Are you going to keep listening to those little thoughts he gives you? slip out of your chair and say, I've had enough. I'm going to get free right now. I'm going to get free of the imaginations I have. I'm going to get free of the high thoughts I've had. I'm about to act on those things. I've got a stronghold already in my life. What are you waiting on? I'm asking you, what are you waiting on? I know what the devil's doing to you. He's putting thoughts in your mind right now, imagination. Don't go. Don't go. People are going to see you. I would say to heck with people that see me. I want to be free. Jesus wants to set me free. He's going to make me demon free today. And I'm going to be healed. And I'm going to be delivered. Heavenly Father, I thank you for people that are coming right now. Lord, they're going to get free in Jesus' name. Look, I know good and well that some of you are, you're lying to yourself right now. You're lying to yourself. You better wake up. I'm going to tell you, the devil's got you. He's got you. He's got you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm asking you to open up the heart of every person right now that's watching online, that are here in this auditorium. Lord God, that we'll not hesitate, but we'll say, Lord, I want to be free. I've got imaginations that are tormenting me, high thoughts that are overcoming me. Lord God, I've got strongholds in my life that I need to break. And I know, Lord God, that right now I feel oppressed. In some areas, I don't want to live oppressed anymore. The Jesus, the Lord that I serve, is going to set me free. And whom the Lord sets free is free indeed, in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody. Let's believe God for this.
Why would I worry when giants come calling my name? My God is so much bigger than troubles I face. And why would I hunger for power or riches or fame? My God is so much better than all of these things. So I won't be shaken. No, I won't be moved. And my God is faithful. His promise is true. So I speak to the mountains. Oh, it's time to move. Come on, do we believe that today? And my enemies scatter, 'cause they know the battle is done. Yeah. And my God is stronger, the victory he's already won. Yeah. He died for my ransom and rose up.
I speak and preach just to get to this moment. I mean, the rest I love. I love being able to share with you the Word of God and challenge you. I'm your coach. But this is the moment I look forward to more than anything else. It's a moment where you get a chance to make some things right with Jesus. Those of you that are watching wherever you are, this is your opportunity right now. You know, how can you be free from thoughts, imaginations, you know, oppression, strongholds, unless you make Jesus the Lord of your life? He's the one that gives you power. You've got to invite him into your heart. Some of you have played church. Some of you just go to church. God wants to be in your heart. He wants to be the Lord of your life. There's no need to live with guilt and shame and condemnation. You may feel conviction right now because you've got that habitual sin, the thing that I was talking about a minute ago, that you're at level 3 and you never knew it. You got a stronghold. You need to break that right now. Why don't you give all of your life, not just the 98%, why don't you give that other 2% to Him? Maybe there's somebody here, you just need to start in the very beginning, give all of your life 100% right now. Maybe you don't know Him. You know Him in your mind, but not your spirit. The devil speaks to your mind. God speaks to your spirit. And I believe the Holy Spirit is speaking to someone right now. Someone right now that's watching. He wants to touch you and change you. He wants to deliver you from all oppression and renew your life. Who is that person? Would you lift up your hand and say, I need to be saved. I need to come back to the Lord. Amen. Amen. You don't have to be ashamed. We've all done this. We all have to make a commitment at some point in time. Anyone else in this sanctuary, in this auditorium, you want to give your life to Christ? You want to start all over again? He's ready right now. How about you that are watching? You can lift that hand up wherever you're at right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, these wonderful people have lifted their hands. They're your children, and they're hurting. They've been bound and they're strangled right now, being strangled by the work of the devil because of imaginations and thoughts and high things and strongholds and oppression, Lord God. But you've come to deliver them by the blood, your blood that you shed on the cross. Today, Lord God, by the way, if that's you and you lifted your hand, you can just pray along with me. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my life. I ask you to forgive me of my past. Help me to start all over again today. Today is my new day. You're my Lord. You're my Savior. Lord, all the imaginations, strongholds, the oppression is going to leave right now. I'm leaving this sanctuary. I'm leaving this service right now. Free, free in the name of Jesus. Whom the Lord sets free is free indeed. Come on, church. Let's give them a good celebration. Let's celebrate their what they just did for the Lord. Amen. God bless you. Pastor Jonathan.
Hey, come on, let's sing some. Hey. There's no mountain too high, there's no valley too low, there's no fear that I fear, He doesn't already know. There's no problem too big, there's no weapon too strong, there is nothing for God that's impossible. There's no mountain too high, no valley too low.
Jesus came to set the captive free. And today we're claiming victory over our minds, and together as a church, we're going to walk out stronger and braver and in freedom. Amen. Such a good Sunday together, you guys. Don't forget to connect with us. You can do that by texting Victory Denver to 94,000 or come hang out with us in the lobby. We would love to talk to you and connect with you, pray with you. We're praying for you for this week. We love you guys, and we'll see you next Sunday.